So sorry to make you come on a Sunday, but then I thought that you people also will be free, isn't it? So previous class we discussed about certain types of hepatitis viruses. Are you people able to recollect what were the viruses that we completed last class? Can somebody recollect? So actually, last class, anybody? How about Ashwati? Can you hear me? Ashwati, Bhupesh.
Yes, see.
Yeah, what did we complete last week, Bhupesh?
Hepatitis virus A, D, E, and C, man.
Actually, we didn't do B, isn't it? We completed A, E, and C.
We told that
B is quite a large topic, so I want to take it separately. So today's class, we'll be discussing about hepatitis viruses, mainly B in particular. But before that, I just want to recollect a few points about these hepatitis viruses. So we already know that hepatitis is inflammation of the liver parenchyma, and there can be many causes for it. Okay, so there can be infectious and non-infectious causes. And among the infectious agents itself, it can be bacterial, viral, protozoal, fungal, etc. And non-infectious causes, yes, alcoholic hepatitis can be there. In IV drug users, there can be hepatitis. There can be hereditary factors as well as just drug-induced hepatitis also, like you heard of this paracetamol hepatitis, isn't it? And then we went on to see that hepatitis, viral hepatitis is primary infection of the liver by any one of these hepatotropic viruses. And we also saw that there were six types of hepatitis viruses. So among this, we had completed A, C, E, as well as G. We know that G was the virus to be discovered last. And A and E are transmitted by the fecal route, and they're very much similar. And C is transmitted by the parenteral route. Okay. And it is associated with chronic disease, cirrhosis, you know, carrier state, as well as carcinoma of the liver. Today's talk, we'll be talking about B as well as D. Okay. So this table also, you must be remembering, I showed you last week. The two different colors, A and E, are fecally transmitted. The remaining are all parenterally transmitted viruses. And we also saw there were other viruses which could cause hepatitis, like most of your herpes viruses, okay? Cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, herpes simplex virus. Apart from it, you have the yellow fever virus, the rubella, and other enteroviruses can also cause hepatitis. Now, coming to hepatitis B virus. So this is a very important virus that you'll encounter during your professional career. And this is a viral infection against which you have to protect yourself. Okay. The healthcare personnel are also equally at risk. It's like an occupational hazard for you people. So in that way also, you should be aware about this virus. Plus for your exams, for your entrance exams, MCQs, you can get a lot of questions from this virus. As we go through this, virus, you'll see that there are a lot of important, interesting points about this virus, which I'll try to highlight during this lecture. Okay, wherever it is important, I'll just stress those points again. So, previous class, I had told you that hepatitis was initially divided into two types, just type A and type B hepatitis. Okay, type A was everything to do with fecal transmission, and type B was the serum hepatitis, or the one which was transmitted by the parenteral route. But later on, they came to find out that there is only not only two types, that is only type A and type B is not there, but there are other viruses, viral hepatitis, which is not included in this A and B type, and that is known as the non-A, non-B hepatitis. And in that only, we came to see about hepatitis E virus and hepatitis C virus. So earlier, type B hepatitis was also known as serum hepatitis because it is transmitted by the parenteral route, blood transfusion and all that. So another name for hepatitis B is serum hepatitis. And this is a very widespread and important type of viral infection. All over the world, you will come across cases of hepatitis B. And it has been estimated that of the total population, 1/3 of the world would have been infected with this virus. And the statistics say that among this 1/3, 1/4 of the people who become infected become lifelong carriers. So carrier state means they will not show any signs and symptoms of the disease, but they will be having the virus and they are capable of transmitting this infection to other people. So these people are dangerous. Okay, they will be spreading the infection in the community. So in this picture, this is an electron microscopic representation of the hepatitis B virus. Actually, this is taken from the blood of a person who is hepatitis B virus positive. So when they did this electron microscopic studies, they came to see that there are different types of particles in a hepatitis B positive person. Okay, not all of them are showing only the viral particles. So let us see what are the different types of particles. So first one is, you're able to see these long filaments. These filaments are having a uniform diameter of 22 nanometers, but the length will vary. So this is one type of particle known as a filamentous particle. And then there is another set of particles known as spherical particles. And these are the predominant number of particles. They are also present in the blood. And these are these small drop-like particles. Okay, they also have a diameter of 22 nanometers. So this is also diameter of 22 nanometers, the filament, but the length is variable. These are spherical particles with the diameter of 22 nanometers. And then you have these 42 nanometer particles. These are known as the Dane particle, or this is the complete hepatitis B virus. So in a blood of a person who is hepatitis B virus positive, you will not only have the hepatitis B virus itself in the blood, but you will also have these spherical elements and these filamentous elements also in the blood. They are in fact more numbers than when compared to the complete viral particles. So what are these two particles? You can see that the surface of this hepatitis B virus is only made up of a particular protein, or it's also known as the envelope of the virus, that is known as HBsAg. Okay, so the surface envelope, you know, excess of it will be produced in comparison with the other components of the virus. So they just form these filamentous and spherical particles. So that is important. Okay. And these particles are later on used by another virus, and I'll tell you how it is used. So in this slide, you saw three different types of particles. So you have the complete virus, which is a hepatitis B virus, a 42 nanometer particle, plus you have the 22 nanometer spherical as well as the tubular particles. All these will be present in any hepatitis B positive individual. Now coming little bit more into the morphology of the virus, this is the only hepatitis virus among the six viruses which is a DNA virus. All the others are RNA viruses. Okay, it belongs to the family Hepatitis Viridae. So HEPA is for hepatitis DNA virus. So Hepatitis Viridae family, and the genus is Orthohepatitis Virus. And the size, as already mentioned, the complete entire virus is 42 nanometers in diameter, and it is known as the Dane particle. And the outer envelope, if you take it up and then if you remove that outer envelope, you'll have the inner core, which is only 27 nanometers in diameter, right? And the core only encloses the viral genome, that is the DNA of the virus, as well as the viral DNA polymerase. And these three types of particles we already saw in the previous slide. And the most abundant are these spherical particles, followed by these tubular particles, and much fewer than that is the entire viral component. I hope that I'm clear so far. In this topic, you know, every point is important. You would have seen in your textbook so much information will be given. So just try to recollect. If you don't understand, just ask. So this is the structure of the hepatitis B virus, and we saw the classification of the virus. A little more in detail about the outermost protein, that is the hepatitis B surface antigen or the envelope. So any enveloped virus will first have a covering which will have spikes on the surface of it. Inside it, there'll be a capsid, a nucleocapsid, which encloses the nuclear material, that is the DNA or the RNA. So in the case of hepatitis B, it has been given a name. So on the surface envelope, whatever is present is only known as the hepatitis B surface antigen, HBsAg. Always this small letter is only used to represent whether it is a surface or a core antigen. Okay. And went on to study in detail about this HBsAg. They found that it is made up of two major polypeptides. And one of that is glycosylated. That means it is linked to a carbohydrate. And this hepatitis B surface antigen shows a lot of antigenic diversity. So that is, throughout the world, if you take different hepatitis B viruses isolated from different patients, they'll all not be the same. They'll all have different antigenic structures. But one thing to be, you know, comforted about is that all of them have a specific antigen, which is group reactive. That means all the hepatitis viruses from everywhere in the world will have a specific group antigen known as A. In addition to it, they have two pairs of type-specific antigens, DY and WR. So you can get four combinations of this antigenic types, four different antigenic types of this virus you can get all over the world. Okay, so it can be ADW, ADR, or AYW and AYR. So these are the four antigenic subtypes of this virus. And throughout the world, you can get different combinations of these antigens. But always A is present. A is a group reactive antigen present in all the hepatitis viruses. So that is why we need not worry about immunity. Once you develop infection or once you have taken the vaccine against hepatitis B virus, it is because this antigen is present, the A subtype is present, we do not have to worry, because the other subtypes, D, Y and W, are not important for immunity. It is only to see the geographical distribution of the different types of viruses. Okay, so this is, you know, this hepatitis B is little more confusing when compared to the other viruses, because you have a lot more to know about this virus. So we saw about the surface antigen. We saw that it is antigenically diverse and it has got a group reactive A antigen, and then type specific two sets of antigens, DY and WR. So either this D will be present or Y will be present. Similarly, W will be present or R will be present. So they will have four different combinations on the surface antigen. Okay, so this is what I explained here. And then suppose you use a detergent, you know that all the enveloped viruses, you use a detergent or a soap, what will happen is this envelope, because it is made up of lipid or lipid, it will get dissolved. So once the envelope get destructed, what you will see inside is the core. And the antigen which is expressed on the core is only known as the hepatitis B core antigen. This is represented by HBCAG. So it's a small C. Okay, like surface antigen was small s. This is a small C. In addition to it, in the core, there is one more antigen known as HBeAg. Actually, hepatitis B E antigen. This is a soluble antigen, okay, not particulate, and it is a part of the nucleocapsid. It's a nucleocapsid protein. So two antigens are associated with this core. One is hepatitis B core antigen. The other one is hepatitis B E antigen. And it will be interesting to know that both hepatitis B E antigen as well as the C antigen are coded for by the same gene. Then where does the difference come? We will see that shortly. So now you have disrupted the envelope and you have gone into the core. So now once you remove the core, what you have inside is the viral genome. And the genome is made up of two linear strands of DNA in a circular configuration. So you have double-stranded DNA. But the beauty of this DNA is that one strand is incomplete. So the DNA of the hepatitis B virus appears as partly single-stranded and it is partly double-stranded. And associated with this DNA is only known as the another enzyme known as viral DNA polymerase. So what this polymerase can do is that at the time of viral replication, it can function both as DNA dependent DNA polymerase and RNA dependent reverse transcriptase, and it can repair the gap in that single strand. No, in, I told you, no, it's partly single stranded and make it completely double stranded. Okay. So then we have come to the viral genome and then the DNA polymerase. So is it clear so far, all of you? Can somebody unmute and tell me? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
You understood so far?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we just saw all the antigens. Okay, now we are going to the genetic makeup of the virus. Okay, so we saw hepatitis B surface antigen, that is the first one, having four different antigenic subtypes. Then we saw the hepatitis B core antigen. Then we saw the hepatitis B E antigen, another antigen associated with the core. And we saw that both C as well as E are encoded by the same gene. Then we went on to see about the DNA of the virus, which is partly single-stranded and it is partly double-stranded. And associated with the viral DNA is the DNA polymerase. Okay, and this polymerase can function both as DNA polymerase and RNA-dependent reverse transcriptase. Now, another important part of this hepatitis B virus is its genome. Okay, it's interesting to study the genome of the hepatitis B virus because of the following reasons. So, first one, what are the genes involved? So, it's got a very compact structure and four important genes. Okay, among all these genes, as you can see in the picture, the largest one is P gene, gene P, and that codes for the DNA polymerase. Okay. Then you have a gene S, then you can see a gene C and a gene X. So the gene S will be coding for the hepatitis B surface antigen. But then it has got a region known as S, and then you have a pre-S and then a pre-S1. Okay. And what happens is when the transcription takes place right from this first region onwards, you have these large proteins being synthesized. From this middle region onwards, when it starts getting transcribed, you have medium-sized proteins being synthesized, and only this yellow region onwards it gets, that is only from the gene S region it starts getting transcribed, you will have only the S gene small proteins being synthesized. Okay, so what is the meaning of that? Is that see here, when the whole thing gets synthesized, you will get these large proteins which are present in the blood. I showed you, know, the filamentous forms as well as the tubular forms. And only the small one, when it is synthesized, that is getting incorporated into your virus as the HBsAg structure of the virus. Similarly, you have these two genes, gene C. What does this gene C do? It has also got a region known as a pre-C region. So when the transcription takes place from the pre-C region onwards, it produces HBeAg. I told you both E and C are coded for by the same genes. And only from the gene C region, when the transcription occurs, it produces the HBCAG. So one gene produces two different proteins. Okay. And then the third gene known as the gene X is there. And that produces a protein known as HBXAG. Okay. It's a new term now. So far, I have not used it. So this HBXAG is a transactivator. Okay. What it does is it enhances the viral replication. One more problem is that this X gene, when gets integrated into our genome, because the virus enters into our cells and then the viral DNA gets integrated into our DNA. So when it does that, you know, it will have some effect on our cellular genes. So that is why, you know, it leads to the cell multiplication. And then, you know, when it becomes uncontrolled multiplication, it will lead to cirrhosis and cancer and so on. So as given in this slide, S gene codes for HBsAg, C gene codes for CAG and EAG. P is the largest codes for DNA polymerase, and X gene, I just told you, know, codes for HBxAg. So four genes, and they are important in the case of hepatitis B virus. And two more important points you need to know here is that, see, there are some hepatitis B virus mutants. You have two types of mutants. This they will ask you the differences in your MCQs, okay, or 2 marks. What you need to know is one is known as a pre-core mutant. Another type is known as an escape mutant. So what is a pre-core mutant? Pre-core mutants are those which are having the, they're not having the ability to synthesize HBeAg at all. Okay. And another set of mutants are the escape mutants. I showed you the A subpart, isn't it? In the ADW, ADR and all that, in hepatitis B surface antigen, escape mutants will show a change or a structural alteration in the A determinant of HBsAg. And these people, you have to be careful. The regular vaccine will not have an effect against this. Okay, the regular vaccine will not protect you against these escape mutants because they have a different A antigen. So earlier I told you, even though there were four different types, all of them have a common A antigen. So because of that, vaccination will give you protection against all these four viruses, okay, four subtypes. But in escape mutants, this A itself changes, the A protein structure changes. So these people who get infected by this virus will not have protection by the usual vaccine that is given to you. Okay, that usual hepatitis B surface antigen vaccine will not protect against these escape mutants because the A protein has changed in its structure. So two types of mutants are there. One is a pre-core mutant and the other one is an escape mutant. Kindly keep in mind, this is very important. And where do you see these escape mutants is that they are seen in babies who are born to these HBE positive mothers and liver transplant recipients. Two categories of people, you can see these escape mutants. And now coming to the pathogenesis of hepatitis B, the virus, when it enters your mode of transmission, I'll tell you, it replicates in the liver cells, okay? And this viral DNA, what it'll do is, it'll go inside your liver cell nucleus, and either it can be free inside the nucleus or gets integrated inside the liver cell nucleus. The problem with hepatitis B is that, in addition to being there in the liver cells, in extrahepatic sites, also the DNA of the virus has been identified, like the bone marrow, spleen, lymph nodes, as well as the lymphocytes. Even though the virus cannot be cultivated in the lab, the proteins can be cloned in bacteria and yeast. And so that is how we have the vaccines being prepared. Okay, I hope I'm clear so far. Before going on to the pathogenesis, I just want to recap. Till now, we saw the structure of the hepatitis B virus. Then we saw the different antigens which are present on the virus, the different proteins or the antigens present on the virus. Then we saw the genes coding for these proteins, right? And then we saw about two types of mutants, the pre-core mutants and the escape mutants, okay? The pre-core mutants are those, what happens? They are not able to synthesize the E antigen. Escape mutants have a different A antigen, okay, A protein on the HBsAg. And these people, these viruses, you know, they can infect a person who's also actively immunized against this hepatitis B because you don't have antibodies to this altered A antigen. I hope I'm clear. Then we saw about the viral DNA, where all it is present. We saw that hepatitis B virus is present also in extrahepatic sites. So saying, I'll just go to the epidemiology. Earlier itself, I mentioned it's occurring throughout the world and you have a natural infection only in humans, and no animals are acting as reservoirs, unlike, you know, other infections like dengue and all that. There's no seasonal distribution, meaning throughout the year, the same occurrence will be there. Usually you get sporadic cases only, and a lot of carriers are there. I told you, no, 1/4 get infected and then so many people become carriers, okay? And in developed countries, usually young adults, adolescents, IV drug users, homosexuals, these are the people who are more at risk of getting the infection. In developing countries, it is the younger age group. In fact, very young children get the infection in the case of developing countries. Okay. And in perinatal age group, okay, that means just around birth, there is an asymptomatic infection. What you should know here is, in the very extremes of age, you know that the immune system is not well developed. Okay, so you don't have an immune response, so you cannot get the virus out of your body. So there is a more chance of them becoming chronic carriers. So in these people, there will be circulating hepatitis E antigen, and then this HBV DNA will be there in these perinatal infected children. There'll be no rise in the liver enzymes. There's no immune response at all, but there'll be a chronic carrier state. You have to be very careful in these children. Okay. So now a few words about the carriers. So whom do you call as a carrier in the case of, this is with respect to hepatitis B only. So usually when you get hepatitis B infection, within 6 months, you're supposed to clear the virus out of your body. Okay. So by 6 months, there should be no trace of the virus in your body. But suppose even after 6 months of infection, you are able to have this hepatitis B surface antigen in the blood. It is still detectable in your blood, even after 6 months of infection. That means you have become a carrier. Okay. So see this age group distribution. Following any infection in adults, only 5 to 10% become carriers. But in children, you see 30% become carriers. But in neonates, more than 90% of the infected neonates become carriers. Why? As I already told you, our immune response when we are very small is not well developed. So you're not able to excrete the virus, or rather get rid of the virus from your body. So it will be there in the body itself, in the liver cells, and then it leads to this chronic carrier state. So there's a chronic irritation of your liver cells leading to all the cirrhosis and other complications. But see, in adults, it is only 5 to 10% who become carriers. And the hepatitis B virus carriers are more common in male, and there are more than 350 million carriers throughout the world. And in India alone, you have 45 million carriers. And this is an important short note, this hepatitis B carriers. And again, there are two types of carriers. So one is known as simple carriers. The other type is known as super carriers. So what do you mean by super carriers? As you say, no, the name super itself means everything is very high. So they are highly infectious, okay? Contain a high titer of, that is high levels of hepatitis B surface antigen. They also have high level of hepatitis B E antigen. So S antigen also is there, E antigen is also there. They have high levels of this DNA polymerase enzyme in the person's blood. The virus is also circulating in their blood, and they have elevated liver enzymes. Okay, these super carriers are highly infectious, okay, because they have high levels of all these things in the blood. And then they have an antigen level and a virus level of more than 10 to the power of 13 HBsAg particles and more than 10 to the power of 8 hepatitis B virus particles in their blood. So they are highly infectious. Okay. The simple carriers, everything is opposite to that. So they are low infectivity. They have a low titer of this HBsAg in the blood. So these people are negative for HBeAg, hepatitis B virus, and DNA polymerase. So they have only this HBsAg in the blood. So usually what happens is the super carriers, over a period of time, they become simple carriers. I hope I'm clear. So just a recap on the carrier state. This is very important. You will come across a lot of carriers in your private practice or in your GP or whatever it is, because so many hepatitis B positive patients are there. Okay. So you have to know who all are prone to become carriers and what is a carrier. Okay. So more than 6 months, if you are still positive with hepatitis B surface antigen, you are labeled as a carrier. And this carrier state is more common in neonates, little less than that is children, and adults only are least likely to become carriers. Why? This is associated with your immune response and ability to eliminate the virus from your body. And more common in males, and two types of carriers are there, simple and super carriers. Okay, super carriers, I told you everything is high, highly infectious, high titers of virus, HBsAg, HBeAg in the blood, and liver enzymes also elevated. Whereas simple carriers, low infectivity, only HBsAg is there in the blood, negative for all the other components. And super carriers in time become simple carriers. At this point, I want to add one important point here, which I want you to note. I told you about HBsAg and HBeAg. Always keep in mind that HBeAg is a symbol of infectivity. So that means the virus is actively multiplying in your blood. So whenever you're able to detect this HBeAg in your patient's blood, it means that the person is highly infectious and the person is having an actively replicating virus in their blood. Okay? Right. Regarding the mode of transmission of the virus, it is a blood-borne virus, noted. But not only blood-borne, parents. So sexual, perinatal route of transmission is also there. Source of infection is a carrier or a patient. So they have been able to detect the virus, not only in the blood, but body fluids, excretions, semen, vaginal secretions, saliva, breast milk, urine, feces, and bile. So it is present in almost all the body fluids. Okay. Then, regarding other modes of transmission, so sexual route as well as the parenteral route is there. So this is the parenteral, you have this blood transfusion, then you have the IV drug uses, okay, and any therapeutic or diagnostic or prophylactic procedure, you have to do it carefully. Okay. And as I told you in the previous class, the medical staff, the paramedical staff have got an increased risk of infection. So at this point, I'd like to add what I told you last week itself. See, when you take three important viruses, blood-borne viruses, one is HIV, then you have hepatitis B, and then you have hepatitis C. Okay. In the case of hepatitis B, if you notice, it is the most infectious among these three viruses. Okay. So suppose you get a needle stick injury from a patient who is hepatitis B positive, there's a 30% chance that you will get the infection from them. Okay. But suppose you get a needle stick injury from a person who is hepatitis C positive, there is only a 3% chance that you will get the infection from that needle stick injury. But suppose you get a needle stick injury from a HIV positive patient, you'll get only a 0.3% chance of getting the infection, that is HIV infection, from that needle stick injury. So this only goes on to say that hepatitis B is 100 times more infectious than HIV. And hepatitis C is 10 times more infectious than HIV. And then only you have the HIV coming in. Okay. And any needle stick injury, the first thing what you're supposed to do is wash your hands or your fingers with wherever you have the injury with running tap water. Use a lot of soap and wash your hands well. Do not add any chemical disinfectants. So why do you use soap? Because they're all enveloped viruses. So when you use soap, you know, the virus gets disrupted. So the same thing principle only we are using for this coronavirus also. It's also an enveloped virus, right? So that is one thing. The second thing is you're not supposed to use any strong chemical disinfectant in the injury because, you know, it attracts all your immune cells to that region. So this may facilitate HIV getting entered into these cells. So that is why you're not supposed to use any strong disinfectants. And again, you're not supposed to squeeze the wound, to squeeze the blood out. You're not supposed to put the finger, injured finger into your mouth. Okay. And you're not supposed to panic. Just go to the nearest wash basin, wash your hands well with soap and water. Keep the wound under the running tap water. So this, I thought it will be useful for you in your practice. Okay. And always make sure that you are vaccinated against hepatitis B because that is one viral infection which gives you protection against, it's one vaccine which gives you protection against two viral infections, isn't it? So we'll come to that interesting part little later. And then there is also a congenital mode of transmission, right? So first one was bloodborne, then sexual, parental, which includes the bloodborne, then the direct contact. This is also had. This has been documented. So wherever, you know, infected skin lesions are there, you know, like an open injury in the skin, and that is exposed to any hepatitis B positive blood, you can get the infection. Then congenital or vertical transmission can also occur. Then now coming to the actual disease as such, I already told you it is known as serum hepatitis. Okay, the incubation period is 6 weeks to 6 months. And on an average, this is on an average, 5 to 15% of the people go into carrier state. That is, this is the longest incubation period among all the hepatitis. Last class we saw 15 to 45 days, then we saw 15 to 60 days, and we saw 15 to 160 days. Now we are seeing 6 weeks to 6 months is the incubation period. And this chronic carrier state, okay, or a chronic infection, if you see, the persistent infection leads to chronic active hepatitis. Then it leads, because this irritation persists, because of that, it goes to cirrhosis, and then this will lead to hepatocellular carcinoma, okay? And a chronic infection, if you see, of more than 5 years duration is seen in 2 to 10% of the patient, and less than 5 years duration is seen in up to 90% of the patients. Okay. And you can get, there can be a premature death because of chronic liver disease in 15 to 25% of the people who are affected. Okay. Right. And the clinical picture is similar to hepatitis A. Okay. But it's a slow onset because it's a chronic disease, slow onset. And it's more severe. You will not get any fever, okay, like in hepatitis A, okay. But there are chances of developing extrahepatic complications. So there can be joint pains, that is arthralgia, urticaria, itching all over the body, polyarteritis, the blood vessels getting inflamed, glomerulonephritis. These are the extra hepatic complications that you can see in hepatitis B infections. Okay, and in adults, I told you, in adults the carrier state is very less. So 90 to 95% of the adults, they recover within 1 to 2 months, and they eliminate the virus from the body within 6 months. But there can be a mortality also. 0.5 to 2% mortality is there, and around 1% will develop fatal fulminant hepatitis. Okay. So what are all the chronic diseases that you can get in hepatitis B infection? So you can get a chronic persistent hepatitis, chronic active hepatitis. The same persistent hepatitis, suddenly it will get exacerbated. You leave it, it goes on to cirrhosis of the liver, and then it leads to hepatocellular carcinoma. So now an interesting part of this talk is the viral markers. So what are all the viral markers and the names that we have already seen? What is the use of all these different viral markers in your diagnosis? Okay, and detection of each marker, what does it imply? So first one is the hepatitis B virus, that is the DNA particle. I told you, you can try to detect this virus in the patient's blood by means of electron microscopy. HBsAg, hepatitis B surface antigen. Another name for it is known as the Australia antigen. Why it is known as Australia antigen? Because this was first detected in the blood of Australian aborigines. Okay, they have done a study on Australian aborigines, and they found that they had this virus in their blood, and so it is given as the name as Australia antigen. So just to know that the first antigen to appear in the blood in the case of a hepatitis B virus infected person is HBsAg. So it appears in the blood after 1 month of infection, and peak levels are seen just before the jaundice sets in. Okay, and when this HBsAg is there in the blood, I told you you should try to eliminate it from your blood within 6 months. Above 6 months, if you are still persisting to have this HBsAg in your blood, you're termed as a carrier. And after this HBsAg, you know, becomes undetectable only, the anti-HBs antibody, okay, anti-HBs antibody appears within 1 week to 2 weeks of the disappearance of this antigen. Okay, so one important point you need to know is, in chronic carriers, HBsAg will continue to be positive, but when you do an anti-HBs, it will always be negative. Okay, so that is an important finding. So many HBsAg positive people, you try to check for anti-hepatitis B surface antigen, they will be negative for that. Then another interesting point is that the second antigen, which we studied earlier, HBcAg, it is not detected in the serum. It will never come into the blood, but it can be demonstrated only in the liver cells by immunofluorescence. So you cannot write a test for HBcAg in the blood. However, the antibody to HBcAg will appear in the blood. Okay, and the first antibody to appear in the blood is anti-HBcAg. It appears in the pre-icteric phase and persists for the longest period of time. However, HBeAg, which is another hidden component, I told you, no, two are there in the core. So this HBeAg appears at the same time as HBsAg, but it will disappear from the blood soon. But this HBeAg can be seen in the blood. Whenever this is present in the blood, it means that the virus is actively replicating and the patient is highly infectious. And once this HBeAg disappears from the blood, the corresponding antibody will appear in the patient's blood. Okay? So in this graph, I want you to appreciate that the first antigen to appear in the patient's blood is HBsAg. Okay? And followed by that, or very close to that, is HBeAg. You will see that HBcAg never appears in the blood of the patient. It will always be there only in the liver, right? But the first antibody to appear is anti-HBc, followed by anti-HBe. And only when the HBsAg stops or gets eliminated from the patient's blood, you will get the anti-HBs antibodies appearing. And in hepatitis B carriers, okay, that is those who are continuing to show this HBsAg in the blood, you will not have anti-HBs detectable in the patient's blood. Okay, and another important point is that, suppose you want to know whether your patient is protected against hepatitis B virus, you have to look for anti-HBs antibodies. So that is what we do when we check the titer. Okay, so this is the level of the protective antibody which we'll be checking. So now a few words on the markers. So how do you detect all these antigens? Commonly used is ELISA. We use counter-immune electrophoresis. We can use radioimmunoassay, and you can use CLIA. Okay, CLIA is chemiluminescence immunoassay. So these are the four different testing modalities available. And HBsAg only is the first test we do. It is a general marker of infection. Antibody to HBs only, I told you, it is a suggestion of immunity to the the hepatitis B infection. So that means if you have detectable anti-HBs in the blood, it means that you are immune to hepatitis B viral infection. And also it means that you have recovered from the infection. In case you have had an infection, it means you have recovered from the infection. In case you are given a vaccine and then they look for this anti-HBs, it means that you are immune to the disease. Okay. And in addition to it, I told you HBCAG you will not get in the patient's blood. But anti-HBC, two important things are there, IgM and IgG. Both are markers of infection. So IgM means acute infection and IgG means past or chronic infection. Suppose you want to know at any time the person has had the infection. Okay, because the antibody to hepatitis B surface antigen, you can get it either because of infection or because of immunization. Whereas this HBC, if you detect in a patient's blood, it means that you had the infection. I hope you are able to understand the difference. Okay. Then HBeAg is the other marker I already told you, means active viral replication. Anti-HBe, when you see it in the patient's blood, it means virus no longer replicating. And viral DNA, when you see it in the blood, means active replication of the virus. And it is a very accurate indicator. But this you cannot detect by ELISA, you can detect it only by PCR. Okay, now coming to the treatment of hepatitis B, you use a combination of interferon and lamivudine. Usually it is well tolerated, but there's a problem of drug resistance. And another problem here is that there's a tendency to relapse when you stop the treatment. So when you want to know whether your patient has successfully responded to your treatment, it means, you know, your HBsAg will have to disappear and your HBV DNA and then the HBeAg, all this will have to disappear. Okay, so that is regarding the treatment. Now, another important aspect of this talk is the prophylaxis or vaccination. You all would have taken this hepatitis B vaccine when you're entering into the medical school. It is compulsory that you have to take it. And usually for both adults as well as children, we give 3 doses. So today, if I give you 1 dose, it is the 0 dose. If I'm starting immunization for you today, 1 month later from today, I'll give you 1 more dose. And 6 months later from today, I'll give you another dose. So that is the dosage schedule. And the vaccine that we are giving is a recombinant vaccine. Okay, so the full virus, we are not going to inactivate and give. But because we know that antibody to surface antigen is protective, what we do is, we take the gene which is coding for the surface antigen, okay, and we do some genetic engineering and we make it a recombinant yeast-derived vaccine. You've heard of a yeast known as Saccharomyces cerevisiae, okay? So that inside that yeast, we'll put the gene coding for this HBsAg alone. And then when the yeast multiplies, you know that a lot of this protein will be produced. So that is purified and it is given as a vaccine. And the usual dose is 20 micrograms, okay? IM, we give it in 3 doses, okay? And it is immunogenic, it is safe, and it is cost effective. And what we do is, at the end of your immunization schedule, that is 6 months are over, isn't it? At the end of that, about 4 weeks from the last dose, we will check the antibody titer. So whether you are positive for the anti-HBs. And if you are protected, it means that the level will be more than 10 international units per ml. This is important. If you are very well protected, it means it should be more than 100. But if your protective antibody level is above 10 itself, it is enough. It means you are protected and you are safe against hepatitis B virus. Okay. Suppose you are exposed, you are not vaccinated. Okay. But you are exposed to a patient who is hepatitis B positive. And what we should do is, we should immediately give you the hepatitis B immunoglobulin. Okay, they protect the people, but you have to give it within 48 hours of the incidence. Okay, and what is the dosage? This immunoglobulin is, you have to give 0.05 to 0.07 ml per kg body weight. So you'll have to give 3 to 4 vials. For a 60 kg person, you'll have to give maybe 3 vials. And each vial will be about 6,000 to 7,000 rupees. So for one person, you'll have to spend 21,000 rupees. So the best idea will be to give the vaccine. Okay, this is only for immediate protection. This is ready-made immunity, as I told you earlier. Okay, but one thing is that, suppose you have a person, suppose you are exposed to a positive patient and I have given you the immunoglobulin. At the same time, I have to simultaneously start your vaccination also. That is only good for you. Okay. And the first dose I will be giving along with this immunoglobulin. After that, 1 month afterwards and 6 months after that, I have to complete the dose. Other prophylactic measures is you have to properly screen your blood donors. Okay. And as doctors, and you should be advising your friends, your juniors, as well as other healthcare personnel to follow the proper blood and body fluid precautions. I hope it is very clear. Okay, these all, each one of these points are very important for you. As far as hepatitis B is concerned, every point is important. Okay, now quickly we'll go to the other virus known as the hepatitis D virus. Okay, and D, I have some things, points for you to remember. Hepatitis D belongs to the Delta virus family. It is a defective virus. Okay, so hepatitis B is a defective virus. This is an RNA virus. And the beauty of this is that, you know, it's an incomplete or a defective virus. That means by itself, it cannot cause infection in the human beings. But it can cause infection in people who are already affected with hepatitis B, or it can infect a person along with hepatitis B virus. Why? Because this doesn't have an envelope. It depends on the excess of this hepatitis B surface antigen particles. I told you, you know, in the first few slides, I showed you those filamentous and circular spherical structures, isn't it? So it makes use of those spherical structures and it creates a kind of an envelope for itself. So the envelope which is around it is the HBsAg. But inside will be the genetic material of this defective virus. So this virus is very much dependent on hepatitis B virus to cause its infection. So that is why, and the mode of transmission you see, it is percutaneous and sexual route. So because it depends on hepatitis B virus, if you are immune to hepatitis B virus infection, it means you are protected against hepatitis D also, because antibody is there against HBsAg. You will also have protection against this hepatitis D virus. So that is the only virus vaccine which gives protection against two viral infections. And one more thing, point I'd like to tell you is that the virus vaccine for HBV, that is the Engerix B or Shanvac or anything, it is an example of a vaccine which protects against a cancer. Because I told you, hepatitis B virus leads to hepatocellular carcinoma. So you're, by giving yourself a vaccine against hepatitis B, you're protecting yourself against the hepatocellular carcinoma. Do you know any other vaccine preventable cancer? Anybody?
Cervical carcinoma.
Yeah, what is the vaccine?
Human papilloma virus.
Yes, you have the vaccine against human papilloma virus. So this also they will ask you. So which are the vaccine preventable cancers? So remember the cancers induced by the viruses. Okay. So was it clear? I have come to the end of my talk. Was it clear? Were you able to understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, see here, I'm giving you my number and I will also put my mail ID. Can you see my number? Okay. And my mail ID, you can always mail me for any questions. So I hope you were benefited by this talk. And in case you have any doubts, you can, Dr. Bhupesh has my number. This is the number and this is my mail ID. You can take a screenshot or whatever it is, and then you can contact me. And in case you want to have any further classes also, you can tell me. Okay, if you're interested, we can continue. So I hope you benefited from this class. And thank you so much for attending on a Sunday. I'm very happy to reconnect with my juniors. Okay, so I hope I was clear.